But let's go back to the shootdown of MH17 and who did it. We don't know who did it. We assume that Russia did it because that's what the government media complex has told us. They don't know whether that's true or not. But that fits the narrative of evil Russia and good Ukrainians. But the question is being raised by some in the media who are actually doing their jobs, mainly Paul Joseph Watson of InfoWars. He is asking, well, let him ask it himself. I don't want to repeat have him repeat what I'm going to tell you he already wrote. I thought it was pretty interesting. Paul Joseph Watson of InfoWars, thanks for joining us again on the Savage Nation.
Hi, Michael. Good to be back.
So what is it you're saying that Kiev will not release? What will the Ukrainians not release?
They will not release the air traffic control tapes in communication with the Malaysian Airlines flight. We know that the first Malaysian Airlines flight that went missing back in March, the transcript of those air traffic control communications were released within 3 days. Yet what happened in this case was that within hours of the downing of Malaysian Airlines Flight 17, Ukraine security services went to the air control towers, seized the traffic control tapes, and we've heard nothing of them since. So obviously you've got Russia coming out with radar images suggesting that this flight was being tracked by Ukrainian jet fighters. If that's not the case, then Ukraine needs to release these air traffic control tapes because they will prove their narrative. They seem to be having a lot of difficulty proving the narrative coming out of Kiev and Washington because most of their evidence is based on YouTube videos uploaded by the Ukrainian government and dubious Facebook posts from so-called rebel commanders that have already been debunked. So all I'm saying is show us the evidence that backs up your narrative behind this shootdown.
Well, look, on the face of it, using logic, Russia has nothing to gain and everything to lose by having downed a commercial airliner. Okay, let's start with that. Right now, world opinion has shifted to the poor Ukrainians. And we learned from our UN ambassador, Samantha Power, that her entire knowledge of the situation is based upon Facebook and YouTube postings. They don't know what the hell is going on. You and I both know it's about the natural gas and squeezing off the Russian cash flow. Wouldn't you agree with that?
It is, exactly. In the larger context, of course, this shootdown happened literally the day after the BRICS nations came out and announced their anti-IMF, anti-dollar system, which, of course, represents a major threat to the unipolar world system, the New World Order being pushed by the likes of NATO and the Obama administration. But you mentioned, again, Samantha Power. There's actually a really fascinating exchange which just came out a few hours ago. It's up on Infowars.com between State Department spokesperson Marie Harf and an AP reporter, Matt Lee, who actually does his job and challenges the U.S. government, you know, acts in an adversarial role, and basically says, look, the, quote, forensic evidence that you've supposedly provided to prove that this jet was shot down by Ukrainian rebels is based on Facebook posts, for example, by this rebel commander. It turned out within a day that this Facebook page was put up by fans of this commander, so the words couldn't even be attributed to him. And the post was talking about the shootdown of a military transport plane. It had nothing to do with Malaysian Airlines Flight 17. So this is the kind of evidence that Washington and Kiev is saying, you know, is the slam dunk that proves this was shot down by the rebels in eastern Ukraine, and it's just not good enough.
Why would anyone have sent a commercial plane over a war zone is the number one question. Other planes had bypassed this exact flight path. Who do you think sent this commercial airliner into a war zone?
It could only have been air traffic control operating out of Kiev. I mean,
all right, wait a minute. Listen to this. So you're saying air traffic control in Kiev lured them over the area?
I don't know if that's the case, but if you look at the previous 10 flight paths of this very jet, MH17, before it was shot down, they all pass well out of the way of eastern Ukraine. Then on this one day, they're ordered to fly directly over the conflict zone. They're ordered to lower their altitude, change their course, and the plane gets shot down. So you've got all kinds of stuff going on in that air traffic control tower, which would give us a great insight into why that plane was diverted over this conflict zone, which the vast majority of other carriers avoided. But they don't want to release the tape. They've seized the tapes, and they refuse to release them.
Well, what you're saying makes sense to me, because neither Russia nor the eastern Ukraine separatists had the ability to order air traffic control to shift the path of MH17 to the north to bring it over the kill zone. There was only one controller that could have ordered that flight to alter course, and that would be in Ukraine itself. Would you agree with that?
makes the most sense to me. And then on top of that, apart from, you know, quote, Russian propaganda saying that the jet was followed by Ukrainian fighter jets, you have aviation experts based out of the U.S. that are saying the same thing, that it looks like it was diverted either with air traffic control, but with also with the direction of these fighter jets. So if we got the released air traffic control tapes, then we would know for sure if Malaysian Airlines Flight 17 was indeed being tailed by Ukrainian fighter jets shortly before it crashed. And, of course, that would change the whole perspective of the official narrative that's being pushed by Washington and Kiev right now.
Mm-hmm. So all you're asking for is release the air traffic control tapes, and Kiev will not do that, to summarize it. Is that correct, Mr. Watson?
That's correct. And there's also another big story we should put out which ties into this, which is Robert Parry, who broke a lot of the Iran-Contra stories working for the Associated Press and Newsweek. He has a source who told him directly that the U.S. has satellite images which show that the missile was fired by Ukrainian soldiers. They've got the images of the Ukrainian soldiers in their uniforms. Now, that's a credible guy. That's not some internet conspiracy theorist. Robert Parry is a credible, award-winning journalist. He's developed sources over decades. He's got a source that's saying that the missile was fired by Ukrainian forces in their uniforms and that the U.S. has proof of that and is not releasing it. So, again, that's just as credible as Kiev coming out and saying, oh, we uploaded a video. Here's a Facebook post where the rebels claim responsibility. That's not forensic evidence. It's not good.
Let's look at who gained most by this tragedy of shooting down a commercial airliner, killing all those people. Did Russia gain? No. Who gained? The Ukrainians gained. So you have to say, let's look at the evidence on both sides before we rush to judgment and wind up banging into another war with Russia, which is, God forbid, what's liable to happen if we listen to idiots like Bolton and McCain who are screaming for war. In more words than one, all you hear from them is, we mustn't let them get away with it. They're old apparatchik of the KGB. We must make them pay. What do they really want? What do they want? What do these lunatics want, Paul?
Well, they're obviously trying to encircle Russia. Russia's not even really expanding. They're being surrounded by NATO bases. But again, I think it's just the threat of a good example of, you know, an alternative system to this IMF system based on the dollar, which the BRICS countries are introducing. Then you look at it in further context. You know, these sanctions against Russia were completely toothless. The Russian stock market has gone up in the past few weeks. They needed a reason to beef up these sanctions, which is now happening in the aftermath of this incident. And Ukrainian forces in eastern Ukraine were suffering heavy casualties in fighting with these separatist rebels in the days running up to this incident, to this shootdown. So if you place it in context, Ukraine was basically crying out for a casus belli to really ramp up both these sanctions and put pressure on Russia not to support these rebels. So it's very convenient timing, to say the least.
Well, the narrative in all the newspapers in America is evil Russia shot the plane down on purpose. If you ask the average jerk in the street who has even a knowledge of this, and I don't even know how many Americans even care about it, they'd say Russia did it and they'd move on. And that's because the evidence was presented by those who want the outcome to be that those in Kiev are the victims and Russia's the evil bear. But there is someone who's writing that this is a replay of the Lusitania scam in World War II, when the passenger ship Lusitania, which, by the way, was carrying a covert military cargo, was intentionally sent into a part of the Atlantic Ocean known to be crawling with U-boats to bait the Germans. And what happened was the Lusitania was sunk. And that then gave the war cries in America that were needed at that time. And right now, we have to reiterate on this show, on the Savage Nation, that neither Russia nor the Ukraine separatists in the East have the ability to order air traffic control to shift the path of the Malaysian plane to the north to bring it over the kill zone. Somebody brought it over that kill zone, and it had to be people in the western Ukraine, in Kiev. That's what most people who have the ability to analyze things are saying. Hold it, not so fast, especially when you hear people like McCain screaming for war.
And here's another aspect to it, Michael. The separatist rebels don't have possession of the Buk missile system. That's not coming from Russian propaganda. That's Ukraine's prosecutor general who stated, quote, the military told the president after the passenger plane had been shot down that the terrorists did not possess our Buk missile systems. So that's Kiev itself admitting the day after the plane was shot down that these terrorists don't have access to those systems. So again, you
When you say terrorists, let me repeat, the average listener doesn't know, they've lost control of this because they don't know as much as we do about this. The word terrorist applies to the Russian proxy forces in the East, right?
Exactly, yeah.
All right. And in Kiev, July 18th, it was published by Itar Tass, militias in the self-proclaimed Donetsk and Luhansk People's Republics do not have Ukrainian air defense missile systems, Buk and S-300, at their disposal. And that was said by Ukrainian Prosecutor General Vitaly Yarima, according to Ukrainian Pravda newspaper last Friday. They said that the terrorists, meaning the Russian proxy forces, do not have our air defense missile systems, Buk and S-300. They said it themselves.
And again, the U.S.'s case, Kiev's case, is also based on another YouTube video. Again, this is their forensic evidence, which they claimed showed one of these Buk missile systems being transported back over the border into Russia, having been used to shoot down the airliner. People investigated that. They saw the street signs. It turned out almost instantly that that missile system was traveling through a town in Ukraine. It wasn't heading back to Russia. So they've got all these so-called slam dunk pieces of evidence based on Facebook posts and YouTube videos, and each one of them in turn has been completely debunked. So what do they have left? They haven't.
Well, I don't look. We don't know who actually did this horrible thing of shooting down a commercial airliner, but we do know that we haven't heard both sides of the story. And I'm not so quick to rush to judgment when the stakes are so high, especially when it makes no sense for Russia to have shot down this airliner. Now, even if a Russian separatist had done so by accident, which is certainly possible, that's not a pretext for war, as McCain and John Bolton seem to think, is it? I don't believe so.
There was a good Peter Hitchens article actually on the weekend which made the point, you know, mourn the victims, but don't turn this tragedy into a global catastrophe. And that's what those kind of people risk doing with that rhetoric. So, you know, if they really want to go toe-to-toe with Russia, it's going to be a disaster situation. Another aspect to this with the investigation is that the black boxes, which have now been recovered, obviously, are heading back to England to be analyzed after initially supposedly being handed to the Dutch to be analyzed. So, of course, British Prime Minister David Cameron has been vehement ever since the incident happened in blaming Russia, and now Great Britain is going to be analyzing the black boxes. So I wonder if...
Are you kidding? Well, MS-13 will set it to say whatever they want it to say. And so the narrative is in, Russia's bad, we need sanctions. It's all a scam to grab the shale deposits in Ukraine and convert it into gas and to crush Russia's economy and to keep the porno shops running in Europe next winter with the shale oil. You know, before you go, and maybe you can stay with us another minute, remember back when we were heard about chemical weapons being used by Assad, and then there were reports that maybe he didn't use them, maybe the so-called U.S.-backed rebels in Syria used them on people themselves? Whatever happened with that story, Paul?
Well, that's interesting because obviously now any skepticism towards this shootdown of the airliner is being characterized as Russian propaganda. It
of course.
Was also characterized as Assad propaganda.
Yes.
Question the Ghouta chemical weapons attack.
Paul, can you stay with us another few minutes? Because that's exactly right. Every time I get up here and try to use logic and reason, they call me a front man for the KGB. I'll be right back. It's 55 minutes after the hour. You're listening to the one and only Savage Nation. We're talking about the shootdown of the Malaysian airline plane from a different perspective. We're asking who actually did it. You've rushed to judgment because Murdoch and everyone else in the media has already said the Russians did it. New York Post, Vladimir Putin did it. Insanity. We don't know that. That's number one. Number two, we learned today that his opposition in Kiev, Ukraine, will not release the air traffic control recordings, which would tell us a few things, namely who ordered the Malaysia Airlines Flight 17 to change course and fly over a war zone. It's awfully suspicious. With us has been the reporter, Paul Joseph Watson of InfoWars. Paul Joseph Watson, welcome back to the program. Paul, remember the Assad incident with the chemical weapons? They all said Assad did it. Some said, wait a minute, maybe the so-called Syrian rebels did this. Whatever happened with that story?
Well, that's right. I mean, for a year beforehand, we were saying, look, they're going to stage a chemical weapons incident. They're going to blame it on Assad. He's got nothing to gain from doing it. Of course, we had the Ghouta chemical weapons attack in August 2013, immediately blamed on Assad based on, again, a YouTube video. We said that we developed sources in Syria that said, no, it was the rebels that were behind this attack. We put that evidence out. We almost went to war based on a YouTube video. January 2014, MIT study, again, not the Kremlin, not Russia Today, this is an MIT study, concluded that the chemical weapons attack could not have been launched by the Assad government because it wasn't launched from a government-controlled area. So again, we were proven right in doubting the veracity of that YouTube video, which almost sent us to war, and again, demonized at the time as Assad propagandists, just as now are being demonized as Putin propagandists when we're just trying to get to the truth of what...
That's right. I want both sides of the story, and I hope my listeners have an open mind as well. Paul Joseph Watson of InfoWars, always a pleasure.